Hello students, it's great pleasure to seeing you once again. Today we'll try to understand about a very important form of energy, and that is sound energy. All of us understand the importance of sound, because the way I am able to communicate with you is only because of this apparatus that nature has given us. That's our larynx or our voice box. And if you just hold your hand on this voice box and speak something, you will be able to feel some vibrations under your fingers, which establishes that sound requires vibrations. Now, what can vibrate? Only matter can vibrate. So therefore, sound is that form of energy which always requires matter. And there is one very important property this matter must possess, and that is this matter which is capable of producing sound must be elastic, and not only should be elastic, it should be under the condition of stress. So if you take a tuning fork and just hold it in your hand and then try to see or hear the sound, you may not be able to appreciate anything. But if you hit it on a soft object and then you will hold close it to your ear, you will be able to observe and hear the sound. So therefore, if you observe this tuning fork very carefully, you will be able to see that it vibrates. And only matter can vibrate. So therefore, sound is that form of energy which is called as mechanical energy. And that is important. Students, whenever we study any form of energy, we must study under three categories. How is the energy generated? How does energy transmit? And how is energy applied? Just now we have seen how sound energy is generated. It's only by vibration of particles, and these particles must be elastic, and that is, they should not only be elastic, but they will be under the condition of stress. So that is the condition for any object to generate sound. The sound we generate and we can hear is called as audible range of sound, and all those sounds which the bodies produce and that we can hear are vibrating with a frequency, that is number of cycles per second, between 20 oscillations per second on the lower side to 20,000 oscillation seconds on the higher side. What is that? 20 cycles per second, that is the lower limit, and 20,000 cycles per second, that is the upper limit. So this is called as audible range of sound. Now there are many objects, including our own voice, that is falls under audible range. The tuning fork vibrates a great number of times, so you can't observe it. So if you examine the tuning fork, you will be able to see the number inscribed on the tuning fork, indicating the number of oscillations it makes every second, and that is called as this frequency. What is it called? It is called as frequency. Now we are going to take this buzzer. This is an electronic buzzer, and if I give its electrical energy is getting converted into sound energy, and you are able to hear the sound. Yes. So it's only because it is vibrating, it is able to produce sound. If no energy is provided, the sound will not be there. So energy of one form is converted to energy of some other form. Now, having understood how sound is generated, let us try to understand how sound is transmitted from the point of generation to point of application. Now, point of generation here is a buzzer in my hand. And point of application would be all of us in this classroom or this room listening to this sound, right? Let us go back to the experiment once again. I'm providing electrical energy to this buzzer, and you are able to listen to the sound generated, right? Now this sound is being produced here, and it is reaching my ears. It is also reaching the ears of each one of you sitting at different locations in this room. So that is important. That sound has to travel from point of generation and point of application. Now, just as it is important to have the properties of a matter generating sound, that it should not only be elastic but under elastic stretch. Similarly, for propagation of sound also, you require a particulate medium or a mechanical medium which should also behave or show the same properties. That is, the medium should be elastic. Not only should be elastic, it should be made to go under the condition of stress. That's what's going to happen. Let us observe by a simple experiment whether sound requires medium or not. So we'll take this buzzer. You are hearing the sound generated here. I got here a glass jar, and this is connected to a vacuum pump. I'm going to withdraw all the matter which would be there, that is matter of air. Now air also has nitrogen 78%, oxygen 21% and some other gases there. They also are behaving as if they were a perfect elastic medium. And then I am introducing this here. You are still hearing a sound. And now I will start this vacuum pump. And I just put my speaker close to it so that you will be able to hear the sound. And then let us start the vacuum pump. All the air inside this. And you find that the buzzer sound has disappeared. We are not able to listen to the sound. Establishing the fact and a very important rule that sound requires medium for its propagation. Once I close this vacuum pump and open this jar again, air will enter inside and you will be able to once again listen to the sound that is produced here. So we have concluded with this activity and experiment that for propagation of sound or transmission of sound or for sound to travel from point of generation to point of application, you require a medium which should be elastic. Not only should be elastic, but it should be under the condition of stress. Did you understand? Are you convinced? Thank you.